Let us discuss about the 2nd May newspaper. The first important thing is the land deal between India and Bangladesh and the recent cabinet agreement to take the Assam out of this land deal. It has become controversial. Now let's get back into the history of this deal. May 16, 1974, the India and Bangladesh agreed on exchanging the conclaves between which are existing between these two countries. On this agreement, 111 Indian enclaves will be exchanged for 51 Bangladesh enclaves. And the second thing is, those who are living in Bangladesh, a Bangladeshi enclaves in India. On Bangladesh, the enclaves will be on the Bangladesh side, but these enclaves belongs to India. These people will become the Bangladeshi citizens from now onwards, and that land will go to Bangladesh. Similarly, the conclaves which will be belonging to Bangladesh on the Indian side becomes Indian territory, and to that extent the citizens living in the Bangladesh territories becomes the Indian citizens. So now there are two things. One is transfer of the land. The second thing is transfer of the citizens. Now many citizens objected to this as violation of their fundamental rights. And also many cases were filed and many cases are pending in the Supreme Court. Now this particular change in the territory of India, it has to be ratified by the parliament. In 2011, various protocols for implementation of land boundary agreement was made with, when Manmohan Singh was the Prime Minister of India. Now in this context, this land deal becomes very much important. Now observe carefully, it is majorly important for few reasons. There is a huge porous border between India and Bangladesh, and it is the major reason for the illegal immigration. And it is impossible for the border forces to control these Bangladeshis coming into India. And the second thing is, Bangladesh is the gateway of India to increase India's connectiveness, economic connectivity with the Southeast Asian nations. And the second thing is, our leakage policy, the major drive is has to come from the Bangladesh. And connectiveness towards Northeast India can happen through Bangladesh. For all these things, there are two major irritants. One is land agreement. The second one is Teesta River Water Treaty. These are the two major irritants between these two nations. Now that's why land deal is very much important. Now what is the implication of the President NDA government decisions? Now Assam will be kept out of this particular land deal agreement. It means in that particular area still the border remains porous. It means the illegal immigration is bound to continue further. And the second thing is Meghalaya has its own objections. If you take Meghalaya, what it says is in that particular state, in exchange of more than 500 plus kilometers, they are just getting 50 kilometers from the Bangladesh. For them, it is loss of territory. So previously, Trinamool Congress very much opposed to this, but however, now it changed its stand. So Mamata Banerjee, she is supporting for this particular land deal. And finally, if you, one more thing is, Assam, which was majorly opposing this particular deal, saying that the illegal immigrants who are there after the Assam Accord, that is March 24th, 1974, according to me, let me verify the date. So any person who is staying in that particular state after that, he has to be sent back to the Bangladesh. So their citizenship has to be verified. Now I see more political drama going on this particular issue. So if land has to be demarcated and the Boundary Act has to be implemented, it has to be implemented in its fullest form. Let's recapitulate now. 1974 is the land agreement. 2011, the Prime Minister Manmohan Singh agreed for a protocol for implementation. Now, 119th Constitutional Amendment Act, and then under this 119th Constitutional Amendment Bill, it's not an act yet. So the Parliament has to provide for the sanction to the shift of the land from India to Bangladesh, Bangladesh to India. So these are the things. Now is the transgender rights. Now, before going into this article, we have to take up the path-breaking judgment of Supreme Court of India in National Legal Services Authority versus Union of India. What the Supreme Court has said is this. So the transgenders also has to be regarded as a third gender. Now, the sex is not just a biological component, it is also a psychological factor. So more than the sex, under Article 14, 15, 16, the word sex, it has to be interpreted psychologically too. And the biological orientation is replaced with gender orientation and sexual orientation. There is a difference between sex and gender. Sex is a biological concept. So much broader interpretation of the sex has been brought up. And next is, the Supreme Court decision or judgment is based on two articles, that is interpretation of Article 19(1)(a) of the Constitution and Article 21 of the Constitution. So according to these two articles, any person has freedom to choose his sex. So it means that what forms his sex is what he talks, what he says about his sex, not what someone is enforced onto him. And the second, he can have freedom to live with the sex or gender which he determined for himself. So 14, 15, 16, the definition of the sex was broadened. And next is Article 19, 21, they are liberally interpreted to protect, to provide for the transgender rights in India. It laid foundation for the transgender rights in India. Now if you see, it means that this judgment provided for the self-identification to the transgenders. Now the present article, what it argues is, in spite of this, the realities on the ground did not improve much. So what it says is, the state has to provide for various social security nets, especially for these transgenders. And along with that, few state governments such as Tamil Nadu are already providing compensation of 1,000 rupees per month. Now it can be implemented across India. And one more, employment opportunities, educational opportunities, sensitivity training in the schools and colleges, all will provide for a better society to treat the transgenders. Again, I will repeat my word. A society where minorities, transgenders, world people, how they are being treated, that determines how progressive the society is, how much important it is giving to the rights of the alternative thoughts and people. So that we need to remember. And next is mines and mineral rights, especially the Adivasi rights. Now if you observe, entire mine or a mineral, it belongs to the state. Anything under the earth, it belongs to the state. Now there is a first act which wanted to regulate this mining, and it is has come up in 1957. So what this draconian law said is, every person who is living above this mine, the Adivasis in the forest, they are the occupants of that particular area. So they are being described as the occupants. As occupants, they may get a minimal compensation whenever that particular land is taken away by the state. In this context, there is a challenge. Now, if the Adivasis do not agree to the compensation paid to them, then the state can continue its activities without consulting them, or it can move forward with its activities. Now the second point is, 2010 and 11, Manmohan Singh government tried to bring some amendments. So what it has said is, as based on the judgment of the Supreme Court, that is Samata judgment of the Supreme Court in 1978, informed consent and share in profits shall be given to the Adivasis whenever they are being displaced from that place to take up the mineral wealth underlying beneath. Now in line with the 2010 law, what it says is 26% of the share or company profits have to be shared with these Adivasis. And added to that, district mineral foundation has to be created. Now, the existing amendment which was brought by the NDA government, it has reduced the scope of this district mineral foundation, and also it is done away with Grama Sabha permissions and everything, and simplified the corporates taking away the mineral wealth of the tribal hinterlands. So this is what is the argument. Now, let's revisit the anti-graft law. The recent amendments suggested by Mr. Finance Minister Arun Jaitley. Now, if you carefully observe that, any ill-drafted legislation, it increases the ambiguity and thereby litigation. And it also creates a fear psychosis, because the vagaries of interpretation of a law, when the law scope is too broad and not defined clearly, makes a honest officer to backpass or not to make a decision. Ultimately, it leads to policy paralysis. Now, especially after 1991, we are talking about a positive, proactive, efficient government. In this context, the Prevention of Corruption Act 1988 is a major hindrance to achieve a liberalized economy in the country. Now, in this context, let's understand the presumption of guilt. So, what is meant by this presumption of guilt? Now, we understand that any person, unless, let's understand presumption of innocence, any person unless proven beyond doubt, he has to be considered as innocent. But on the other hand, the section 13(1)(d) subclause 3 of the Prevention of Corruption Act says that it provides for presumption of guilt. It means it do not provide for any leeway for the investigative officer to think or to presume that particular individual may not have done a particular mistake. Here, an adverse presumption is straight away drawn when without the necessary for the investigator to look into the dishonest intention on the part of the officer. So any law, first we need to check the intention and then the act. Here it is presuming that his intention is dishonest, the article, the section 13(1)(d). Intention is itself is dishonest. On that premise, the investigative officer is starting his investigation. So that is one thing which has to be amended. And next is, if you see carefully, the growing importance of PPPs and also the private companies, they provide for huge opportunities for corruption. So in this case, the law has to be very balanced. The provisions of the law shall not harass the hardworking officials. And the next is, the self-preservation of the public officers has to be overcome with. And next is, the law provides for stricter penalties. Yes, it is good. On the other side, it also includes the supply side of the corruption. Now, in this case, tomorrow, at a later date, if a bribe giver is asked to testify against the officer, he may probably do not come forward because there is a guilt on his part too as per this law. So in this case, what the article suggests is, we shall be able to discriminate between coercive corruption and collusive corruption. In a coercive corruption, yes, the supply side of the corruption is more forced than real. So in this case, we shall give an opportunity for him to testify against that. And next is, the prior permission are for the prosecution of the government officers. Now the section 197 of the CRPC, it provides for the prior prosecution of the previous officers. The Prevention of Corruption Act provides for the prior prosecution necessary for the existing officials. Now the existing amendment wants to bring them close together. But there are few cases which are where there is a visible corruption. If you can take about the inappropriate assets or disproportionate assets, a person who is caught red-handed taking the bribe. In these cases, the protection for in the form of giving permission for prosecution can be removed. So because these are blatant corruption which is visible on the face of it. And the next is, no changes in the law can bring about immediate effect on the surface of the implementation. So implementing agencies have to be strong enough. Now you know, anti-corruption bureaus and CBI, all these are being riddled with huge work. And probably, so the implementation is the major problem, major deficit in India. So that needs an urgent intention rather than all these things. Now, again, let me talk about them. So we need to create positive and proactive administration. The law shall not be an hurdle. So we have to provide for a clear, unambiguous law is one thing. And second thing is, we have to provide for the presumption of innocence rather than guilt. The law has to be based on that. And the third thing is, we have to provide for protection to the so-called as the person suffered on coercive corruption tomorrow to testify again as the corrupt officer. And third thing is, ere there is a corruption, blatant corruption is visible on the face, we shall be careful and no protection with regard to the permission on prosecution is necessary. So these are the improvements which you can suggest for. Thank you. Next is the NJAC, National Judicial Appointments Commission. Now what it has been said is, a person not having a judicial knowledge, he cannot judge the so-called the competence or judicial competence of a judge. And the second thing is, the two prominent people or eminent people will be selected by a political forum, majorly consisting of politicians, that is Prime Minister, Leader of Opposition and the Chief Justice of India. It means it is mostly a political decision. And these two eminent people have veto powers on appointment of a particular judge. And it means that the independence of the judiciary may be compromised as per this National Judicial Appointments Commission. That is what is the today's argument on this. And it's going to continue further. Let us see that. And thank you very much.